I'm a businessman, yes, I'm an entrepreneur. Ooh, yeah. I'm a businessman, yes, I'm an entrepreneur. Ooh, yeah. I'm a businessman, yes, I'm an entrepreneur. I'm a businessman, yes, I'm an entrepreneur. Ooh, yeah. Crystal Mitchell, do you have my business plan? Just review the pages of my marketing plan. Yeah. Crystal Mitchell, do you have my business plan? Too, just review the pages of my marketing plan. Got my capability statement down the
road. And good afternoon, and welcome to the Business Zone with Crystal and Gilbert. We are glad to have you tuning in. We're excited. It's fun. We got some fantastic guests today, and we're looking forward to sharing all our information and their information with you to make sure you have successful businesses. So let me tell you something. Gilbert is on his way, so he'll be here in about 15 minutes. He's on that dreadful 10 freeway. Which has been a mess this week. I've been on the freeway all week long going out to Mount Sac. It was a nightmare. Monday through Wednesday, I was so happy that yesterday came and I did not have to go out to West Covina. And so the 60 was bad, the 10 was bad, the 405 was bad, the 105 was bad. There was no freeway in this city that was in it, that anywhere that you wanted to be. So I'm glad I don't have to deal with it today. And Gilbert is dealing with the 10 because he's coming in from Alhambra and he should be here shortly. But let me tell you some of the fun, exciting things that I did this week. This has been just a paramount week of meeting people and talking to people. If you guys noticed last week, you only heard my voice. You didn't see me because I Skyped in. I was at this amazing conference of women, and we were there in Long Beach at the Hotel Maya for 3 days. And let me tell you, there were 20 coaches, myself a business coach, but then there were 20 coaches from every aspect, I mean, from spiritual to lifetime to E-suite to executive level coaches. And we all spoke and presented to a female population, with women that had come out to enhance their lives and to be better and to create better businesses. It was an absolutely awesome experience. I spoke on networking on Friday afternoon, and then on Saturday morning, I did a workshop, a coaching session, actually, and it was on building relationships. So it was pretty phenomenal. One of the techniques that I used was that we are all 3 degrees of separation from everybody that we know, and or 6 degrees, it said, but in my case, it was actually 3 degrees. There were 20 coaches plus another 25, 30 women. So there was about 50, 60 people in the room. And out of that 50 or 60 people, 25 people I had relationships with. I knew who they were. And they also had connections to most of everybody on my Facebook and everybody on my LinkedIn. So that's pretty amazing, building a relationship. So that was pretty awesome. And people were like, wow. And I went around and I was able to connect all the people that I knew in the room to each other and how I met them and how I actually ended up on the show. It was a pretty awesome experience. We had some breakthroughs. Some women recognized some things that they wanted to work with. So, and then let's see, what do we do? So if you guys go to my Facebook, which is Crystal Mitchell on Facebook, you'll see all the video. We did a lot. I did Facebook Living of the sessions. It was really pretty cool. And it was great with the sisterhood. So our purpose is to create a women, a female synergy that will bring our people and us together as women and create healing in our community. That was the purpose of why we were there. So it also, with that, we realized that we could actually create a corporation out of all of the coaches that were there. So that's something that we're going to look at doing and go across the country and across the nation, everybody in their own area of expertise. It was a pretty awesome experience. And then I also got a couple clients out of it, or potential clients. It was just really cool. So I'm looking forward. So the next one will be in January. And so you guys stay tuned. And it was funny because a couple of people said, like, Krista, I really wanted to go to that, but I didn't. It was kind of costly. And then I told them, I said, you know what? You should have called me because I actually had free passes for a couple of women and nobody ever called. So you guys cannot miss out on opportunities. You never know what the universe has in store for you. But if you don't ask, you don't receive. That's kind of how it works. Okay. So the other thing that I did this week, which if that wasn't enough, so Monday I jumped right on into a new thing, the Milken Institute. Do you guys know who the Milken Institute is? They are taking on an endeavor. It's called Partnership for Lending in the Underserved Markets, and it is the acronym is PLUM, P-L-U-M. And the purpose of PLUM, it is an initiative, it is a joint effort by the U.S. Small Business Association and the Milken Institute to identify and implement practical recommendations to increase lending to the underserved markets. The initiative will focus on piloting efforts to enhance access to capital for minority-owned businesses in two markets, the Baltimore Pilot Initiative, in particular, will focus on African-American-owned businesses, while the Los Angeles Initiative will focus on both African-American and Hispanic-owned small businesses. Both demographics, in particular, suffer greatly during and after the recent financial crisis, and small business lending to the underserved markets in Baltimore and Los Angeles, indeed, nationally, has yet to recover. So here's some interesting stats. In the African-American population with the SBA loans, which is the Small Business Administration, there is actually data out there that in 2015, there were only 69 actual loans that were received by African-American business owners out of some 400,000 businesses. Okay, and we have a guest today who's going to talk about that because he's with Vermont Slauson, Vermont Slauson Economic Development Center. So we'll talk with him about that. In the Latino community, it was a lot better. So 431 loans were actually received from them. So then they say we went up 20% because we went from 69. Actually, I think it was 48. In 2015, and then it went up to 69 in 2016. So 20% increase. You're right? 20%, not. So that is why this initiative is coming, is being put on the table. And the Milken Institute is very interested in making a change. So they're partnering with the SBA and the partners of the stakeholders in our community. So the bankers, the EDCs, the other lenders that are in the community, and as well as some of the nonprofit organizations that work in the economic space. So I was there as representing Recycling Black Dollars. It was a pretty awesome experience. We actually sat down and we had breakout sessions, and we talked about the different areas, policy and regulation. We talked about, let's see what we have here, policy and regulations, leaders in enhanced finance, entrepreneurial ecosystems and emerging sectors, and the economic development in established sectors. So those are the areas, and we kind of brought up solutions to the problems that we know exist, and then we're going to come together and create a change. So the SBA is going to have to make some changes. We all know that, especially if you've been dealing with small businesses, you cannot go to the SBA and get a loan for a startup business. Does not exist at all. They tell you, but it doesn't exist. So that's one of the things that has to change. The credit criteria has to change. After the recession, nobody has decent credit. So they're going to have to work with that. Also, the collateral, an issue for our small businesses. Sometimes you just have your business and you may have your equipment and you may have the orders that you have, and that is about as great as you get from a collateral standpoint. So we brought all those to the table. Some other issues we talked about were, do we need incubators and accelerators that are specifically for our service-based businesses, our mom-and-pop businesses, so that they can learn how to run businesses better. As I have like to say, and I think everybody here will agree with me, that in the black and brown, the Hispanic and the black community, we go have businesses by default. All right, with nobody, you didn't probably wasn't raised with someone in a business that was a business owner. So you come up with a fantastic idea and you say, okay, I can make great barbecue. So I'm gonna open up my doors and I'm gonna become a restaurant. And you don't know how to run a restaurant, you just know how to cook. Or you know how to fix cars. So the next step is I'm going to have a business, man, because I can fix a car. So those are the areas that we have to work on. So now here's the thing. If we're going to create a change with the SBA, with the assistance of the Milken Group, then we as business owners and those of us in our community, they're going to have to step up their game as well. So we're fighting for you, but that means you're going to have to fight for yourself. But we have to change where we are, because our communities hurt the most in this. And what is going on in our cities today is a direct result of the lack of economic power in both of our communities. And that's what we have to change. So we have some great guests today that we're going to talk to about these issues. Hey, Margo, thank you for joining us on Facebook Live. So my guests that are here in the studio, we are Facebook Living because we got to be all in the technical thing. So, Denise, hello. Lita, hello. Wanda, hello. You guys can also come in on and call in at 323-293-3375. And in addition to that, you can sign on at morrismedialive.com and you can actually watch us live. You don't have to just watch me, although that's cool. You guys are watching me. That's cool. But I would really like for you to call in so you can see, because you can't see my guests. You can only hear me. So we want you to see our guests. They dressed all up pretty for us today. They're all looking good. So I want you guys to see them. So again, morrismedialive.com. And then if you just want to stay on Facebook Live, that's fine. Hey, Alicia, how are you? I just talked about the women's, the Bella Network. I have Celeste coming in later on. She's going to talk about it. And next month is going to be the Business Zone honor to the woman business owner. So the whole month is going to be on honoring and uplifting our female energy and our business acumen. And I tell you, women are doing things out here. You guys, my guests will probably tell you that as well. And as you know, my co-host says he prefers to do business with women because they pay on time. So... Because he said we're all about business, so he's thrilled about that. Hey, Alicia. So we're going to introduce our guests. Actually, they're going to have to introduce themselves because I don't think I got a bio on them, which is cool. So we're going to let them introduce themselves. And who do we have coming in? Ah, my co-host is here. So you want to do a break? So we're going to take a break so my co-host can get situated so he can come in, because he knows the Blue Group law firm better than I do. So maybe he can introduce them. If not, they're going to introduce themselves. Okay, we'll see you in a moment.
Is a cloud-based, all-in-one business management procedure and market research system that is uniquely designed to help minority business owners become business-ready, contract-ready, and bank loan-ready. This powerful tool makes running your business a very simple and easy process. Small Biz Pro provides immediate access to key documents in 10 seconds or less, so no more searching for those important documents when you need them. It gives business owners a sense of order and confidence. Are you ready to become business ready, contract ready, and bank loan ready? Then log into smallbizpro.net and get your limited free trial of Small Biz Pro today.
Welcome back to the Business Zone. This is Gilbert Buchanan along with my
co-host Christo.
All right. And we're here with two wonderful guests today from the Blue Law Group. And we're going to have some fun today on the show. It's about 25 minutes after the hour of 3 o'clock. Our phone number here is 323-293-3375. That's 323-293-3375. So all my entrepreneurs, go ahead and give us a call so you can check in and get some legal advice, some free legal advice. Okay. So, Crystal, we want to go ahead and introduce our guests.
Actually, I didn't get a bio on them, so we're going to let them introduce themselves.
Oh, that's even better.
So I shocked one. I asked him, was he the founder of the organization? He's like, founder. So we're going to let the founder introduce himself.
Why, thank you.
All right. So we're going to go ahead. I'm going to start from my right. So we've got Chris here, Chris Garcia. So, Chris.
Hey, thanks, Gilbert. Thanks, Crystal. Thanks for having us on the show.
Welcome.
Yeah, we're excited. We got a lot of things going on this year. My name is Chris Garcia from the Blue Law Group. My role for the law firm is business development and marketing. I've known Blue almost 7 years now. Our target for practice in our arena has really been a focus in business, tax, and criminal law. Me, for a marketer and a business developer, I'm always out networking with a lot of surrounding businesses in the community. We have an office located in Rancho Cucamonga and also downtown Los Angeles. So within those business communities, there's a lot of parallel for business information and just with working with business owners, and it kind of parallels to legal services just in general, you know, that cross over for those kind of specialties. And Blue, Michael Blue, also has a lot of specific background in tax. That's been his focus in the last few years.
Okay, excellent. Thank you, Chris. So, Michael, do you want to tell us a little bit about you?
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Gilbert. Thank you, Crystal.
You're so welcome. We're very happy to have you on the show.
Thank you for having us. As Chris was saying, we are definitely focused in on business, transactional. We've also done, obviously, some criminal law and really all sorts of law. But our primary focus has been on business and taxation and helping companies, especially startup companies, get the background that they need, get the knowledge that they need, and really help them to develop more transparency and a direction. And so let me introduce myself a little bit. I'm Michael Blue. I am a lawyer. I'm also a certified public accountant. And we've got a couple offices out in L.A. and Rancho Cucamonga. But we are a Latino owned business, and we certainly are committed to the community, to the black and brown communities. We are full endorsers of these communities. We're part of the community. We realize that as part of our communities, we do have a deficiency in these areas, but we're absolutely committed to giving them that kind of direction, and so that's what we do.
Okay. Excellent, excellent.
Fantastic. So before you got here, Gilbert, we were talking about the initiative that the Milken Institute putting in place for both of our communities, mm-hmm. and how that can help. So let's talk about our businesses, and being that they are underserved, meaning that, and I had told Michael that, you know, sometimes we don't get the information or the knowledge or the resources until it's too late and we can't make the proper decisions. Mm-hmm. And I think that really applies in the legal area, because most of our businesses do not, they don't have two things. They don't have a team with an attorney on it, and they do not have a team with a CPA on it. So those areas are generally weak spots. Those very are weak. Very weak in our businesses. Yes. And so when something happens on any level in our business, if it deals with the legalities of it, mm-hmm. we're usually behind the eight ball. So would you like to speak on that?
Yeah, I'd love to. And this is true for all businesses that are generally starting up, but primarily for minority-owned businesses. You know, I used to actually focus a lot in my younger years right out of college. I was focused on accounting, and so I was almost basically an expert in taking businesses that had not had any accounting for 4, 5, 6 years, 10 years in some cases, and go back and just clean everything up, mm-hmm. and it's just an absolute mess. And from that point on, for the last 2 decades, I've been a huge promoter of saying, you know, look, it's so important to get the right foundation mm-hmm. When you're starting businesses, to make sure that that accounting is done correctly, that the record keeping is done correctly. And that just was such an instrumental thing that I saw in my early years. Now, as a lawyer, it's even worse because, you know, you have agreements. Most people don't realize this because they don't – we're really not taught this, you know. And so it wasn't really until law school where I got instruction that I'd never thought of in the past. And the instruction was that a corporation is really just a piece of paper. It's a piece of paper that you register with the state of California. And everything after that are relationships.
Right.
And these relationships are agreements. And the agreements are contracts. And contracts can be verbal. They don't have to be in writing. And so what happens, a big problem in our communities especially, is we'll have family or friends, or, you know, we'll sort of trust each other. And so we have these agreements that we think, you know, from our perspective, we think that we understand the agreements.
Right.
But from the other person's perspective, they have a different understanding of the agreement. And that doesn't generally come out until 4, 5, or 6 years later. Mm-hmm. And that's when everything blows up. And that's where you really have the true problems that we have, particularly in the minority-owned businesses, because they haven't gotten the lawyer to write these contracts up to help with the negotiation. Because a lawyer isn't just, hey, you know, do this, do that, or here's the law, here's a contract. A lawyer can also help facilitate an agreement between two parties.
Right.
So one party, you know, may want to, you know, I have a client, for example, that this person has an independent contractor that's created all of this knowledge over 30 years and is actually producing this knowledge on paper. And so the owner is sort of stuck. He's been using that knowledge and not realizing that's a potential lawsuit downstream because you're using that knowledge without paying for this person.
Right, right.
So this is something that could be, you know, downstream, a lawsuit for undue influence and potentially even fraud. And so to bring a lawyer early on, so vital, because you can actually bring these things where both these parties may not be thinking about it, to actually put it on for them to think about, come to an agreement, pay some money, rent it, do something, but that will save you 5, 6 years later mm-hmm. when if that material becomes very valuable, millions of dollars especially, then all lawsuits, everything is in play, everyone is after each other.
That is very, right. very good information.
Yeah.
And one of the things that I experience in the industry, because I work with a variety of different industries, I work with construction, retail, manufacturing, you name it. But one of the industries that is pretty rampant when it comes to legal activities and how things are done properly is the construction trade. Mm-hmm. As you guys know, mm-hmm. I've worked with LA Unified School District, LA Community College District, LA Metro, all of those guys. And when small businesses get awarded a contract, they get awarded a subcontract. So the bigger guys are the primes. They get the contract. Now, when they get the contract and they subcontract to these smaller subs, they don't really establish a contract agreement. They just tell them what to do. Mm-hmm. And then when it's time to pay those subs, they don't want to pay them because they're going, I didn't tell you to do that. That's not what I told you to do. So, and that's part of the problem I have. And that's why I developed my system called Small Biz Pro, to make sure that these small businesses have their documents in place and they understand that they need to request certain legal documents. Now, the only agency I know right now, and I'm not trying to, you know, give them any free press or free promotion, but I've noticed that they're the only ones that push for subcontractors to have agreements with primes, and that's LA Metro. They're the only ones that do that.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Wow.
They force them to have subcontract agreement. Otherwise, they're non-compliant and they don't get paid.
Wow.
So these are the types of things I'd like attorneys like yourselves to promote out there, push it, and let these contractors know that, hey, not because this is a prime contractor and they're big means that you're going to succumb to what they tell you.
Yeah.
Request a subcontract agreement.
Yep. And the thing, and one aspect is, and I think you're hitting a good point, Gilbert, is as a subcontractor, sometimes you might feel like you're out leveraged.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, one thing I think, especially for minorities, you know, we sort of all feel like we're out leveraged.
Oh, yeah.
We start out out leveraged.
Oh yeah.
And we're lucky if we ever get just slightly out leveraged.
Oh yeah.
But you know, so I think one of the things that maybe should be put out there in the public square is that that we really have a lot more leverage than we think we do.
Oh yes.
And it's not uncommon at all. Nor is it disrespectful. Nor is it something that's not part of the regular course of business to go and say, why don't we draft a contract? Why don't I bring my lawyer in? You bring your lawyer in. And that and actually, if you have a business partner, a contractor, a general contractor,
right,
who's giving resistance, that should be immediately a flag that may not be the person you want to be doing business
Definitely.
With.
Right.
And by us having workshops and informing some of these small businesses that they've got a right, and the right is to have a subcontractor agreement, will definitely be something that's really valuable.
And I would think also when you're dealing with a larger organization, they already expect that. That's the only way they're doing business with other people, right? So I would think that would give you that much of a level of respect. It's like, oh, wow, okay, they're doing business the way business is supposed to be done. So when we're afraid to ask for those contracts, that puts you in a different light, right? Because that's saying you don't have the acumen to understand that I have a business and I need to protect that business, and the only way I know to protect that is to have the necessary contract signed in place so that we are both in agreement, at least in the beginning, initially, that this is how we're starting out.
Exactly.
Now, it may go awry down the line, but we at least have a baseline to work from.
Exactly.
Right?
Well, and it'll go awry less down the line because one of the biggest aspects of getting an agreement up front is, as I was mentioning, you may not be on the same page to begin with early on. And it is the negotiation in the early stages where you get on the same page, where you mention, hey, if I leave, I want 50% of the receivables.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And you may have just presumed that, and you're presuming that, hey, it's 50-50, it's two of us. But when you leave, this other person may think, well, I spent 90% of the capital on this, so I should have 90% of the receivables.
Right.
That's something you want to discuss up front.
Exactly.
So there's transparency, and when you do leave downstream, the likelihood of a lawsuit and ugliness is much less prevalent if you have that agreement up front.
You know what's amazing when it comes to agreement? And I've done this over and over. I've tested it. I've put it in practice and all of that. And it comes back to the same thing. I'm not knocking IT guys. I'm not knocking programmers. But programmers and regular people are never on the same page.
Never.
They say certain things. That's not what we perceive. Because I've hired so many programmers to help me with my system, to write programs for me. And the words they're using, it doesn't mean the same thing that I understand it to mean.
Yes.
You see what I mean?
Yes.
So then when we get down to it, they said, that's not what I agreed to.
Yes.
And I said, well, that's not what I hired you for.
Yes.
And then we have a problem.
Right. Yes.
They speak computer.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's a different language.
Oh, yeah. So that's another reason why, you know, we need to have this in writing and have it spelled out.
Yes.
Right.
Now, Chris, I know you've done a lot of work also. What are some of the types of work you've done with small businesses that
bring
your expertise?
Well, I think what I see in the community, too, is when you have a small business, you're going to have almost two parallels of a business. You're going to have possibly a creative mind or possibly the creative aspect of the person, the stronger person in the company. They're going to be the dreamer. They're going to be the person that's like, hey, this is what we put this on the program, you know, we put this, you know, to fish and we grab the fish and make the business successful. But then they don't really have the business tools to put things in place. Mm-hmm. You know, they don't have the operation or maybe the experience for the admin. Mm-hmm. So you kind of need both. You need possibly a business person and the creative, you know, the marketer, actually even the talent, you know, for the business. And I think it relates to all different types of industries, you know, whether it be computer industry, manufacturing, restaurant, just service and sales industries. I think you really have to get your foundation down strong. But, you know, that does kind of curve the business plan aspect of if you know, kind of do the R&D too long, then you lose investors, you lose the motion of the business. So I think there's probably not a right or wrong way to really get into the business, but as long as the elements, I think, are done at one point of time, the sooner the better. You know, as Mr. Blue was suggesting, is, you know, when you have, you know, contracts, agreements, and vendor documents in place, it allows you your business to grow. And even the same thing is, I talk to small businesses, and sometimes they don't have capital to really get to the next level. And, you know, actually peeling back with, you know, Mr. Blue, he has a lot of CPA background, is you got to really kind of do the work. You know, having receipts and tax returns is great, but you got to really do a step further. It's like, let's look to see the growth of the business, you know. Are we going to just do the same thing we did last year? And, you know, I think that's what makes businesses truly successful, is if you're able to kind of look in the mirror and see, you know, what businesses, you know, you want to really, you know, and the market share you want to really enter into. You know, everyone can say, oh, let's get all these accounts, but what's realistic? Let's create a plan. You
know, now, Crystal and I, we work very, very closely and intimately with small businesses. And one of the first, we work with startups and we work with existing businesses. We try not to discriminate because all businesses need a shot. The startup businesses, it takes forever to get them on board because they have a different concept of what business is supposed to be, so we have to guide them. The existing businesses, they understand what they need to do, but a lot of them are not doing it. You see what I mean? So that creates a problem too. So what Crystal and I do when we're interfacing with small businesses, we look at their legal structure to see how that is set up. And by having that legal structure, whether they have a corporation, an LLC, sole prop, partnership, or whatever, based on that, then we look through their corporate documents to see what's present, what's not there, what they need to have done. Now, when we deal with corporations, one of the problems or issues that we come across is the buy-sell agreement. So I would really like you guys to see if you can shine some light on that for the audience so they can hear.
As well as partnership agreement.
As well as partnership agreement, yes.
We were talking in the car on the way over, and it was something just kind of in passing. There's a lot of restaurants in L.A., and there's a lot of competitiveness. Is you might have a chef, you might have a brand name of business. What really makes it successful? Is it the food or is it the business model? There's a restaurant that we know in city of San Bernardino, and if you could share with that, is one restaurant had a name and sold it, and then the other business went across the street.
Yeah,
kind of ties into the topic. Yeah, well, it's the same owners, and it's, I mean, right across the street, like walking distance, and the same menu. So, you know.
So
address that, then the partnership agreement, then buy-sell agreement.
Okay. So this is a naming convention. So every contract, and this dates back centuries, the theory of contracts is an old area of law that dates back probably close to 1,000 years at least. We inherited it from the English with the traveling judges in England. What came out of that was what was called the English common law. We inherited the English common law. And so this idea of contracts and agreement dates back to the very early years at the English common law. And so what that entailed was that, hey, you know, if two parties agree on something, so long as it's not illegal and it's so long as it's not doing certain things that are immoral and that kind of thing, we should respect them. And so embedded in every contract is the notion of good faith and fair dealings. And that's actually imposed a duty to act in good faith and fair dealings. So you can't go into a contract sinisterly concealing things and trying to get leverage by, you know, failing to make admissions or reveal certain things. For example, like a car. You know, you're a used car salesman. You say this car's never been in an accident when you know it has been in an accident.
Right.
And so the other person buys the car based on your representations, your misrepresentations.
Right.
You've violated that duty of good faith and fair dealings. You've also committed fraud, but that's another story for another day.
Right.
So in this case, we noticed there was a restaurant, and this goes to a buy sell. The owner of the restaurant had sold the restaurant and had set up shop next door, mm-hmm. and with a name substantially similar to the name of the restaurant that he sold. And so, Chris and I were discussing, before coming in here, how that's an absolute lawsuit ready to happen, because if nothing else, this person has violated the good faith and fair dealings by setting up shop with a name substantially similar, which is confusing the public, mm-hmm. and next door. Right. And so you can tell, whenever you are, and this is good for all business owners, whenever there's really sinister stuff, it's all about intent in your head. Mm-hmm. And you can never find out what's in someone's head. So the way you show what's in someone's head is what were the actions that they did that we could all see? Mm-hmm. Well, the actions this guy did was name a restaurant exactly, right. or, almost right. like his right. previous restaurant. And then not go 5 miles, not go to the next city, not go to another state, but go about 20 feet.
Oh. And the menu might be menu. Just the same, right?
10 cents cheaper.
Yeah.
And a little cheaper. Oh, even 10 cents cheaper? Oh, wow. Undercutting on top of that, right?
Exactly.
Unbelievable.
So with respect to buy-sell agreements, there's a lot that goes into the buy-sells. One of the things I think that people will come to us, for example, is really you come to a lawyer and you think, okay, law, and everyone thinks it's serious, and we're sort of scared to go right. into the law office.
Right.
Look, one of the really key points, particularly in a buy sell, mm-hmm. is you will figure out some things that you weren't thinking about. I mean, forget the law for a second, and forget the paperwork, and forget the signatures. You're going to go in because you've probably never done it before, or you don't have a lot of knowledge in the particular areas. Now, as a tax guy. And a business guy, I mean, probably pretty close to a tax expert. CPA, I'm board certified in taxation mm-hmm. By the state bar. I always see business, there's business and then there's the tax part of business. And business lawyers will always look to the tax guys
right.
to finalize and sanitize the deal. So when I see a buy-sell, for example, as a CPA, I'm looking at assets, I'm looking at value, I'm looking at what the amount that you're buying this for and where that amount is going to go to the assets, because I'm going to probably try to attribute every part of that value mm-hmm. to the fair market value of all the assets, so there's no taxable gain on those assets.
Okay.
And then anything else above that, I'm going to attribute to goodwill if I'm representing the seller, because I can potentially get a capital gain, which is a much lower tax rate for the seller. Mm-hmm. Now, for the other guy on the other side, with respect to the business and tax, that person's looking in the opposite direction. That person wants the value in the assets, because the higher the value in the assets, the more that person can depreciate, which is a tax deduction over time. If it's stuck in the goodwill, they're not going to be able to depreciate it. Mm-hmm. So that is one huge aspect why you're going to want to have a lawyer on both sides, because if I'm the lawyer on one side, and then you mentioned this a little bit earlier, that some people don't have representation and this kind of thing, and some of the general contractors have their lawyers,
right.
and they're seeing the independent contractors without lawyers, and they already know that they can abuse them.
Right.
If I represent a large corporation, and I do represent some large corporations, the first thing I see is if they don't have a lawyer on the other side, I'm going to abuse that person.
Well, of course.
Because it's my job to right. defend and advocate for my client. And a lawyer on the other side, it's their job to defend and advocate for their client. Mm-hmm. So if you're sleeping at the wheel and you don't get that contract with the general contractor, mm-hmm. I am going to stick as much of that value in the goodwill and get a capital gain for my client. And you're going to get stuck with all this goodwill that you're not going to be able to depreciate over years and years and years, when you could have stuck it all into your equipment mm-hmm. and depreciated it over time. And so buy and sell is exponentially complex in a sense that you need to know where the value goes, how much the value is, how to value your corporation. I had a client come in and this person thought that the value came from a valuation expert, and that the valuation expert said, you can't sell this business for more than the valuation. Well, that's absolutely not true. You know, for one, that's what goodwill is. Right. You know, accountants created goodwill to offset the value of the equipment and the purchase price. If you sell Pepsi, for example, and it's $4 billion or $40 billion, if you count up that equipment, it's probably worth $4 billion. So right. Where is that $36 billion? It's in the goodwill. It's in the name. The name has a brand.
And also the other side to the buy-sell is having a corporation or an LLC with other shareholders.
Yes.
And you definitely want to make sure that you have this agreement in place.
Yes.
So let's say Crystal and I are partners. We have a corporation.
Yes.
I should die. What happened to my asset?
Exactly.
Does it go to my family? Does it go to other shareholders? Who does it go to? So those are things that are supposed to be stipulated in that buy-sell agreement.
Absolutely.
So that and also – because you're putting that in the buy-sell agreement, another thing that small businesses are not aware of, because a buy-sell agreement is really critical to a small business, especially when they're doing certification, their corporation, they're doing certification. Many of them don't know that. So when the certifying agencies request these documents, they're going, what is this? What is this document? Why do I need it? Well, that's a part of it, because the certifying agency are certifying them, so they're entering into contract with a public entity.
Mm-hmm.
So should one partner die, what happens with agreement with the public entity? So they want to know. They want to know who's going to assume ownership in this business. Is it going to be your spouse? Is it going to be the family? Is it going to be all the shareholders? Are you going to sell the stocks? And if you do sell that, who has first right of refusal?
Mm-hmm.
So all of those things are things that are supposed to be in that buy-sell agreement.
Absolutely. I mean, it would be malpractice for a lawyer to draft something, a buy-sell agreement, a shareholder agreement, a partnership agreement. You're always going to have in those agreements, you're always going to have the triggering provision when one of the business owners either dies or sells,
mm-hmm.
wants to get out,
mm-hmm.
or the other owners want him out. Or her out.
Right.
So you are going to set that up. It is not complicated. Mm-hmm. Usually, you can return the original capital investment and you're out, and it's like an 80% vote. So it's usually a super majority, because you don't want it just to be a simple majority. But if the rest of the people don't want you there anymore,
right.
you get a super majority, you kick them out, and then you give them an agreed in whatever agreement you have. It's going to be in the agreement that we're either going to return your capital and now you're out, or we're going to do something like over the last 3 years of income, you get 20% of this year's, 15% of 2 years ago, and 5% of 3 years ago, and that's going to be one sum, and that's going to be what you get, and then you're gone.
And all of that has to be written.
Absolutely,
Crystal.
And I would
more?
Actually even suggest for that particular paragraph, initialing.
Initialing. To make sure you understand.
Yeah,
it.
Yeah. I would actually, and I do this a lot with my clients, is I have the opposition initial every paragraph.
Oh, that's actually a good idea. And it's so funny that you said that, because there's a couple of businesses in Los Angeles that there is the same name, same menu, same everything, and one's up the street from the other. And when I asked that question,
give them my number.
Yeah, right. I'm like, well, that didn't make sense. And when I asked, they were saying that they were family.
Yeah. It's usually that way.
So why are y'all, that to me, that's diluting the business,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
If half the business is going to go up here and okay, there's something else behind this story and you guys are just not telling me.
Usually when that happens, is because there's feud within the family. Sisters and sisters or sister and brother or cousin.
Yes.
There's feud in there.
Right.
So one person get upset. Okay, I'm going to show you. I'm going down the street. I'm going to set up
and literally, this one is about a block. They're like maybe not 20 feet. They're maybe about 30 feet. They're on the other corner.
Yeah.
I'm like, well, wait a minute. I'm confused. Even the customers are confused.
Yeah.
Well, which one do I go to?
Well, one has a secret menu and one other has a secret ingredient.
<Yeah. laughs> And they decide they need to be in secret places,
exactly.
Right? And then the other one that I found here in this community is there's a business here in L.A. I won't call either one of their names, but the individual was a chef for this one business, And then he decided, for whatever reason, I guess they had a split. And then he opened up a business on the corner, up a little ways down on the other side. And so it's very close to this studio, actually. And because it's a soul food type of a menu, the person is not black. That opened up the new business, but they make sure that their employees are, so that people think it's a black-owned restaurant. It's like, okay, all of this duplicitous behavior. So both of those are lawsuits, and we probably will turn them over to you. Because at some point...
Please do.
At some point, someone's going to need a lawyer.
So, Crystal, do you have any other questions for our guests?
So what have been some of the... concerns with some of our small businesses, because, you know, our startup businesses really don't have anything. And usually they don't get anything in place until crises have come and threatened to shut them down. Yeah. And then that's when you guys get your phone call.
When their chef moves a block away.
And I, too, am in the accounting industry. I do the books for clients. And generally I'm called in when there's problems and I need to fix everything. I'm the troubleshooter. So I come in, it's like, what have you guys been doing up until now? So do you have that same?
Oh, yeah, yeah. And from our perspective, you know, I'm a trial attorney. So, you know, I see the ugly of the ugly.
Right.
And I'll tell you, you know, I've seen partners that really, really loved each other, you know, and 5 years later, they're at each other's throats. And I've seen a business unravel with one bad decision, literally unravel in bankruptcy, multiple lawsuits. You know, the party's now going into bankruptcy court to try to kick them out of bankruptcy so they could basically take the carcass and take everything that this person has had. It gets very ugly very quickly. And these are and one of the aspects that this business did, aside from making that one very, very bad decision, was not line up their contracts and not line up their agreements correctly. And so, so yes, I do see a lot of the numbers. I see, you know, as an accountant, I see, I look at those numbers, and you know, it is one problem that if a business doesn't have their numbers correctly. And I'm my you know, I'm representing a client that's suing you. I'm going to go after those numbers. I'm going to find them. And if they're bad, you're going to end up paying badly for that. So it is worth, you know, spending the time, spending the dollars to get those books done correctly, because there's just an assortment of problems aside from, you know, relationships breaking down and suing each other with a bad, you know, buy-sell agreement or bad partnership agreement. But you also have, you know, I mean, you have the IRS potentially coming after you. And you know, I represent clients in the IRS, in the United States Tax Court. I've seen clients that don't even own part of the business are getting pulled into these this litigation. And when the government comes after you and they say, you know, you owe $600,000, and even though you don't own the business, we're holding you responsible, I mean, you can't sleep at night for the next five or 6 years.
Right, exactly.
And so it is crucially important. You're absolutely right, Crystal. Get the numbers correct. Spend the time, get a bookkeeper. You can get a part-time bookkeeper. Heck, even if you're a small enough business, there's some CPAs out there that, that charge like $400 or so, you know, if you don't have a lot of transactions, to get your books correct. And you need to take that off your shoulder and make sure that it's done correctly.
Attorney Blue, I'd like you to also address this for us. Because
hold on, if anyone have any questions, and you have this free legal advice right here, because they are on the show, so they'll charge you afterwards when you actually come to them, but they're going to give you a little bit of tidbit right now. So you guys need to call in at 323-293-3375. Everyone on my Facebook, Marjorie, hello. Keith, hello. Keith, glad to hear you're in Dallas. You just got back from Hong Kong, I see, huh? Marvin, we stream live at morrismedialive.com. For those of you that are getting feedback problems, join us at morrismedialive.com, and you can see us streaming live, and please call in at 323 323- 293-3375. Okay.
Oh, Gilbert. That's good, Crystal. I like to do shout outs also to my viewers.
and Gilbert is doing Facebook Live for the first time
today. Doing it for the first time.
Well, you know, that's new, right? It just came out not long ago.
Oh, yeah.
A month ago?
Definitely.
No, it's been out for a little minute. Yeah.
So, Gordon Nixon, thanks for watching. I want you to continue watch. Gordon Nixon is a construction contractor, so he's really enjoying this conversation we're having about contractors. Angelica Grace Velasquez, thank you for watching also. And Chris Garcia, thank you for watching, sir. Appreciate it. Yolanda Horn, thank you for watching. Keep watching. The information we're disseminating today is going to really help you in developing and growing your business. Now, a question I wanted to ask here to Attorney Blue. Already know the answer to that, but I want you guys to get the answer from him yourself. Now, so I'm best friends with Crystal. Crystal is my best friend. We're in business. And because we've been in business for so long and we're friends for so long, over 20 years, we don't have an operating agreement. We don't have anything like that. But because we're friends, you know, we don't really need that because we're friends. What do you have to tell the listeners regarding that, Attorney Blue?
Secret handshake?
Secret handshake.
I say, he's right there with that secret menu.
Well, I say that it touches on the same theme.
Oh, we got a call?
It touches. Do you want me to?
Let him finish his.
Okay.
So it touches on the same theme. It really, it's great that two people get along, that you and Crystal got along. And I would say that now is the time, you know, to go and hammer these things out, because you want to do it when you're friends. You want to do it when you're willing to talk with each other. You don't want to do it when one of you is suing the other, because no one is going to agree on anything. You're going to end up spending a ton of money on lawyers. And trust me, lawsuits can get to $100,000 easily within a month.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Easily.
Wow. In a month?
In a month.
Mm-hmm. Whoa. Okay.
It is ugly. People don't understand it. They get emotional. They hire a lawyer, and it's $100,000. You're in, and now you want to get out. And when you're at this stage, it's very hard to talk to each other.
Yeah.
Yes. So when you're friends and when you are really getting the business going, you're really excited, sit down for a couple hours, hammer it out, get a lawyer, get someone to at least advise you, and then you could put the agreement on paper and you both sign it. And now you both know what your agreements are.
Well, the advice I usually give to my clients is that you may be friends, and that's great. But when it comes to business, it's a totally different thing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So you and that person, it's good that you're friends, but that person and you aren't friends when it comes to your money.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
That's how I put this in perspective, and it works.
Yeah.
I think we've got a call, so let's see what this call is.
Hi, good afternoon. I have a quick question. Now, my business is converting from a hobby into a business, and I want to lay the financials down correctly, the bookkeeping, do I go with QuickBooks, all of that. Where do I go so that I can get that foundation laid correctly before I do get in trouble?
Okay, caller, you've come to the right place. So what we'd like to do is to have you identify yourself, tell us your name, and tell us where you're calling from, and we can help you out.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'm Margot Levette. Hi, Crystal.
Hi.
I'm calling from Gardena, California.
Excellent. Thank you for calling. You said Margot?
Yes.
Thank you for calling, Margot. Well, you know we've got a resident resident accountant and bookkeeper in the house, right, Crystal?
But I know she stays so busy.
I know. Well, we're developing a team right now. Crystal, we're building a team around her, so we'll definitely be able to help you. So, Crystal, you want to take this one?
Hey, Margot. Yeah, actually, I spoke with a couple of people today, and Gilbert and I have been speaking on this. You're right. I've gotten extremely busy, but I got to make things happen for you guys, so I can't be behind a computer working on numbers when I'm bringing some real stuff to you that can help grow your business. But I've identified a couple of people that I can refer you to. I'll initially meet with you and then determine which one and what type of who do you need and what you will need, and then they'll take it from there. Actually, Margo's been in a couple of my classes.
Good.
And Margo has a radio show as well. She's, in fact, But when she was in my business class, that's what she was working on.
Excellent.
Yeah, so
excellent.
She's a brand new business owner, and she took a leap of faith and left her corporate job with a corporate paycheck every 10 days.
See, Margot, you are doing what you're doing, Margot. You're personifying an entrepreneur, because that's what an entrepreneur is all about, taking risk.
All right.
So you have taken the first step.
Yeah.
Now, here's what I'm going to do, and I'm going to have you tell me a little bit more about your hobby that you're converting into a business in a minute. But here's what I'm going to do for you, because I want to let you know that you've got a lot of love on this side of the phone helping you out, okay?
All right.
You know, I have a program called Small Biz Pro that we promote here on the program all the time. Okay. It's a business management, procurement assistance, and market research assistance system that helps small businesses to become business ready, contract ready, and bank loan ready. So here's what I'm going to do for you today. I am going to give you a free lifetime subscription into that system. You see what I'm saying, Margo?
Yeah.
Okay. Who loves you, Margo?
You love me.
Okay. That's what I'm talking about. So we're going to give that to you. So I want you to leave your phone number with our station program manager. And we want to talk off the air. We'll give you the website address so you can log in and register. As a matter of fact, are you in your office right now?
No, I'm not.
Okay, that's what I thought. So give her the number so we can reach out to you. Okay. We're going to have you register in the system. And we're going to walk you through the process and show you how to upload your documents, all your finances, your business plan, your business license, your insurance, all of those things. So you can access those in 10 seconds or less from anywhere in the world.
Oh, my goodness.
Sounds like a plan?
Yeah.
That's what I'm talking about.
That's the foundation.
That's right. So before we have you before we have you go, what type of business are you thinking of doing, Margo?
I believe that we all have to. We can all talk about our businesses. Nobody can talk about the business like you can talk about it.
That's so right.
We all need an infomercial.
Yes.
Everybody needs an infomercial. We need to saturate ourselves with social media.
Yeah.
So that's what I'm moving into, actually producing and coming up with these infomercials for brand new businesses, because we don't have a lot of money, but we have to let people know what we're doing, how we're doing it, and where they can find us. Infomercial, you can use it more than one time.
Yeah.
You can chop it up. You can even do a podcast and chop it up.
Oh, yeah.
Backroom products. You can do a myriad of things with your own voice, with your own time, maximizing everything that you're doing.
You know Crystal is good at that, right?
Oh, I know she's
good. All right. So Crystal is definitely going to be helping you out with that too, right, Crystal?
Yeah, you guys know that I'm a true entrepreneur, man. I wear a whole bunch of hats. He's not the only Jamaican here. I just came about it differently.
Crystal is Jamaican also. She's got 15 jobs.
And lots of skills. Because you never know when you need to sell a new skill to make some money.
I have a business card for that.
And, 12 business cards, each different one.
And Margo, what we're going to do also, we're going to also give you the number for the attorneys here in the studio. So if you need that legal guidance, they can guide you so you can do things the right way. What we always recommend is that small businesses start the right way, because then it will get you to success much faster than the ones who didn't do it the right way. Because when you don't do it the right way, guess what? You're going to have to do it all over again and again and again, because you're going to stumble many times.
I don't want to do that.
Yeah,
so you
want
to start.
I don't have time for that.
Right, and you want to start your business correctly, and I'm sure that Mr. Blue and Chris would agree with us that if you start that team out the right way, and you already have them in play, they already understand what your business is and what your directions and your goals are for your business, then they can help guide you to getting to your end zone much faster and without a whole lot of challenges and stumbling blocks and $100,000 lawsuits.
Yeah. And you said something interesting when you said you're converting a hobby into a business, that triggers particular things that you want to be careful of.
Yes.
particularly in the tax code, hobbies, you're allowed to take expenses up to your revenues, but you're not allowed to take losses. And so you got to be careful with how you make sure that you, anything that you do where you're actually showing that you're trying to make a profit, brochures, that kind of thing, you're going to want to keep copies of all those things in case the government comes and tries to say that this is merely an extension of your hobby. You've continued to do it as a hobby. And so if you're getting losses, especially early on, which is pretty typical of an early company, you're going to want to be able to have proof 3 years later when the IRS comes calling that, hey, we were trying to make a profit, and here's my brochures, here are my proofs that I've been doing that. So these losses I can take, and so I'm not responsible for these penalties and interest and fees that you're charging me.
That's perfect. Fantastic. So Chris and Michael, would you guys like people to reach out to you and acquire you want some new clients?
Yeah, and we could you know, we're happy to give you like an hour of free consultation also. You know, if you just want to come in and just get some advice, you know, I'm always happy to do that.
How do they reach you?
You could reach me. I'll give you you could look up bluelawgroup.com, www.bluelawgroup.com. We also have a phone number. I can spill it out. You probably won't be able to remember it, but it's 909-945-0121.
You want to repeat that, please?
That's 909-945-0121.
Okay. Yeah, and like what Mr. Blue was saying is if you guys mention, anyone out there mentions the radio show for today, we offer free hour consultation, and we have available location in Rancho Cucamonga and also Los Angeles, and we also have available consultations over the phone for those some of the people that maybe aren't nearby.
Yeah.
Cool. And we actually, Gilbert and I have talked about this. We like to create our own resource directory for those that have been on our show, because that's the whole idea, is bringing you on the show. So you'll have access to more information and be able to reach out so that it works for both of us. Mm-hmm. And then after this show is over, we'll make sure that you guys get a clip of your part, and you can use it on your website. You have media on your website.
Definitely.
Not too far from the camera.
And then we'll also share it with our in our classes and workshops as well. We got some big stuff going on, so you know, we can do some stuff together and do some referral.
I'd love to.
Because we want our businesses to be well represented and to be ready beforehand and after the afterhand. We don't want to do the afterhand thing. That's the
afterhand is equivalent to the backhand.
Right. Yeah, exactly. It's not cool. So we're trying to make sure that they get all that information, those resources and tools, before the opportunity arises, right?
Okay, so that's great. So what we're going to do, we're going to go ahead. We want to thank you guys, because we want to make way for our next guest on the show.
Great.
So thanks again for coming by.
Thank you, Crystal.
Really appreciate
thank you, Gilbert.
It.
Thank
you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Have to have you guys come back on again, Chris.
Pleasure.
Absolutely.
So we're going to go ahead and take a break right now, and we'll be back in two.
Okay. All right.
Is a cloud-based, all-in-one business management procedure and market research system that is uniquely designed to help minority business owners become business-ready, contract-ready, and bank loan-ready. This powerful tool makes running your business a very simple and easy process. Small Biz Pro provides immediate access to key documents in 10 seconds or less, so no more searching for those important documents when you need them. It gives business owners a sense of order and confidence.
Are you ready to become business ready, contract ready, and bank loan ready? Then log into smallbizpro.net and get your limited free trial of Small Biz Pro today. Is a cloud-based, all-in-one business management procedure and market research system that is uniquely designed to help minority business owners become business-ready, contract-ready, and bank loan-ready. This powerful tool makes running your business a very simple and easy process. Small Biz Pro provides immediate access to key documents in 10 seconds or less, so no more searching for those important documents when you need them. It gives business owners a sense of order and confidence. Are you ready to become business ready, contract ready, and bank loan ready? Then log into smallbizpro.net and get your limited free trial of Small Biz Pro today.
So we're back on the air. This is Gilbert Buchanan once again, the small business paramedic, along with my co-host,
Crystal Mitchell.
And we're on the Business Zone, and today we're having some fun here in the studio. We just had the Blue Law Group here with Michael Blue and Chris Garcia, and we got some great information from them earlier, and now we're going to go to the Vermont Slauson Economic Development Center. They've got some much more information on economic development and how small businesses can benefit from their services. So, Crystal, you want to go ahead and introduce our guest?
I certainly will. Fernando Borja. Borja. He is okay. Fernando's career is in the business industry and has a strong foundation in marketing and public relations. As a facilitator of micro business workshops and developer of multilingual materials, English and Spanish, for his classroom curriculum, Fernando currently works as a business development specialist and loan officer at the Vermont Slauson Development Corporation. In this position, he is responsible for marketing programs, conducting orientations, training, and providing one-on-one counseling with new and existing businesses, and provides loan package assistance. Fernando was working with the Skid Row Development Corporation, a nonprofit, as a business management instructor for Strive program for the past 5 years. Welcome, Fernando.
Thank you for having me. Thank you, Chris, and also Gilbert.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you.
And we're kind of excited. I met Fernando at a breakfast mixer that the Vermont Slauson was hosting at local business Louisiana Kitchen. And I sat next to him, we were talking, and he said something that I didn't know even existed. I don't know if there's other programs out there, but he does a business writing program class for Vermont Slauson that's in Spanish. Yes. So I do a business writing class in English. So I was kind of interested. And so I thought, let's bring him on and see how that works. And are there other programs like that within this community over here?
Community. Well, they used to be in Rice. We used to be a community financial resource center. Mm-hmm. Also, I work there, and I facilitate also the trainings, the coaching. People that are they're excited to start a business, but they didn't know how to do that. So I used to be a trainer there, a coach.
Oh, okay. So you agree with me that our businesses fall into business?
Yes.
and a business plan. Who the heck needs a business plan, right? I already know how to cook. I don't need anybody to tell me how to put the business together. I already know that. Is that what you get?
Yes.
Okay. Do you guys get a big turnout? Are you working on it?
We are working on it.
Okay.
Yes. We see that our community, I mean, because I provide that training in Spanish, I see that community that is kind of hard to understand that they had to write a business plan
okay.
from A to C, how they want to be conducting the business before they started. They had to see in writing, but it's kind of hard for them to do that.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah, I would imagine because the concept, right, is getting that concept of business, because they still have to do both languages depending on where their businesses are located, right?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Okay.
So most of these clients, are they Latinos or are they other people as well? Or is it primarily Latinos?
Well, I do for both. I for the brown and black community.
Mm-hmm.
But in my case, they brought me for because I speak the language, the Spanish.
Right.
And I provide in Spanish.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So you do the business plan in Espanol?
Yes, sir.
Excellent. So you find that many of these guys that come in, they say, oh, I got my business idea up here. I don't need a plan, right?
Yes, it's a lot of people. And I explain it to them that it's like you go to a trip. If you know exactly how many hours you're going to be spending, how much gasoline you're going to be needed, how long you're going to be taking the trip, what's the weather, and all kind of stuff, probably you're going to be ended in someplace else.
Right.
Exactly. Now, here's my thing. I've hosted, over the last 9 years, I've hosted many business plan classes, and generally I might get 10% of them to actually complete the business plan. So 1 year, I also teach, I'm a certified a business plan trainer for NIFTY, which is Network for Teaching Entrepreneurship to Kids. So I had just done a business camp that was a 11-day camp, and the kids had a completed business plan done in 7 days. So of course I was teaching an adult class, and we couldn't even get past the first chapter.
Thank you. I feel so good here. Because I was thinking that I was the only one.
Oh, no. If you get a business plan, if you get 10% of all the people that you teach, if they actually get a plan finished, you're doing really good.
So what percent of the population would you say are Latinos that come to the facility?
Well, right now I have 26 students that are coming to the class.
Mm-hmm.
But they're coming from all the way from South, Central, and Mexico. So right now I have a combination, the salad that they have everybody there.
Okay. Are you doing both English and Spanish or just?
Right now I just doing it in Spanish.
Oh, okay.
You think they're listening right now?
Yes.
You want to say a little bit of this interview in Spanish so maybe they can understand you?
Yes.
And then you just interpret it in English.
Okay.
This is a first on the Business Zone. bilingual broadcast. Awesome. So go for it, Fernando.
Okay, ¿qué tal? ¿Cómo están? Buenas tardes. Mi nombre es Fernando Borja y trabajo para Vermont Slauson. Aquí en este lugar tenemos clases, un curso de 8 martes, de las 6 de la tarde a las 8:30. El curso es completamente gratis y les enseñamos desde cómo obtener su licencia, sus permisos, cómo desarrollar un plan de negocio desde la A hasta la Z.
You know, I understand everything you just said, right?
Yes.
Okay. So you said, hello, my name is Fernando. I teach a business plan class. It's on Tuesdays. And I think you said 8 o'clock?
6 to 8.
6 to 8. Okay. And you said you teach them how to obtain licenses and permits.
Yes.
And all of that, right?
Yes, sir.
See? Look at that. Such a talented co-host I have.
I've been learning. So that's good. That's very good.
So I think you and Michael and Chris can do some business together, huh?
Yes.
You might want to have them come in and because I usually have guests. Do you guys bring in guests from?
Yes, okay. And I would love to invite you guys.
Yeah.
Because, part of the training that we provide, we talking about the people that they had to bring in and make it a team. It's the lawyer, the CPA, the person from the bank, the consultant, and also the people who get the insurance. And we added another person. Now, they used to be five, right? But are now social media.
Yes, social media is very
16
important.
Or 17 platforms, you have to learn how to attract your clients.
Now, let me ask this question, because here's something that I have, especially my older clients. You know, they're very resistant to social media, right? They don't, I don't need that. I have no purpose for social media. And so it's very difficult when those of us have embraced it, because that's really the way of marketing your business now. You still do your traditional, but if you are not doing, if you're not including social media, I mean, and they're making it, I mean, right now, we're doing Facebook Live and we're on the radio, but that's a way to build up our audience. They don't get that.
Well, in that class I explained it to them, how many of you using the Yellow Pages? And everybody look at me like, excuse me? So, Thomas Guy, excuse me, especially millennials.
Right.
Like you talking about...
It's a dinosaur.
A Chinese or... No, I'm talking in Spanish.
I'm speaking in Spanish. What's the problem here? Huh? Yeah, they just don't get. Oh wow, we're gonna have. They don't get the. They don't understand that. That's the new wave.
Yes,
and that's the new wave. And you, as the business owner, you have to make sure that you are. That you are embracing all of the ways, because if we traditionally, because I see you also marketing and public relations, right? So if most of our businesses can't afford traditional marketing.
Nah. Well, I telling a lot of stories in the when I give in the training, and I telling that when like 4 years ago, I went a trip to South Dakota, driving with my kids and my
dogs. South Dakota from Los Angeles.
From Los Angeles, took me 26 hours.
Wow.
But I didn't, I didn't drive the whole 24 hours. But I tell it, I explain it to them, talking about social media, how it works. I have two teenagers in that particular time, and they were like, let me tell you where is the next gas station. Let me tell you where is the next hotel. As a matter of fact, I already have a room for you. We know how much it's going to be costing us. And all of the details. So my teenagers, they're using the whole social media.
Right,
and,
exactly.
And everything. And I explained to them, could you imagine I would be still...
Yeah, you'd be still driving.
Looking for South Dakota.
Exactly. So it just makes your business, and for even for us, I mean, for Gilbert's business, for my nonprofit, for our joint business, without social media, man, we actually, one of our shows, we after the show when we uploaded, it was uploaded to YouTube, we actually reached Africa. We have a number. We had about 15,000 posts reach on that particular show.
Yes.
And there were people in Africa that were actually going, oh, my God, this is fantastic. You know, this is great information. Because and they were young. There were a lot of young millennials in Africa that was interested in hearing what we're talking about. And so even now, even when I do anything else on Facebook Live, because they've been part of that before, it pulls them back in anytime I go live.
That's great. So,
and I explain it to them because I have a different ages, you know, like I have some of the millennials.
Right.
And when I start talking about something, they were like,
right, exactly.
To see
the verify.
Right,
verify why they're sitting in the room with you to verify. So it's really
know what you're talking about.
Right, exactly. and it makes a big difference. It makes a big difference. So how many times do you guys do this class?
Well, like I said, it's 8 week, 8 Tuesdays, but it's 8 weeks course. After we finish, we start the other one.
Oh, okay. Oh, really?
So every 8 weeks.
Every week. Wow, yeah. That's pretty courageous, because I only do it twice a year, but every 8 weeks?
See, as a matter of fact, the next one is going to be November 15th.
Excellent. Okay, so anybody there that in the Spanish community that would be more comfortable learning how to write your business plan in Spanish, then please reach out to Vermont Slauson Economic Development Center They're located here in Los Angeles, and enroll for Fernando's class.
Yes.
Excellent.
You're going to be having so much fun.
Okay. You're going to have so much fun. That's cool. I think it's really great, though, that we are meeting the needs of our community. And I know I've had a number of individuals in my class that their first language was Spanish. And so they were having to embrace the English part, translate it to the English part into the Spanish, and then come back. So that's a little bit more difficult for comprehension.
But like I said, it's fun. Okay.
That would be pretty cool.
So, Crystal, who's our other guest in the studio?
We're our other guest, and you guys are in for a treat. So, Miss Faith has an extensive history working with nonprofits. She organized and implemented community events for family. She is experienced in fundraising and overseeing and coordinating volunteer activities and opportunities, networking, collaborating with various entities from the healthcare to government. But why she's here for us today is because a couple of weeks ago, we had a tribute to the founder of Recycling Black Dollars, Muhammad Nazarene, and she did a poetic rendition that was absolutely phenomenal. I didn't send you the music. It was on. It was inside of the email I sent you with the outline. What's the song that you do it to?
It's Closer to My Dreams. It's the instrumental version.
Maybe we can have you do it live.
Yeah, she's gonna, I don't sing the song.
She's gonna no, she's going to do the poet.
I don't sing the song.
So it was just so heartfelt. She captured Muhammad's spirit so much so for us, especially for those of us that have known him. And for those of you that don't know, Muhammad Nazarene is the founder of Recycling Black Dollars, and he started it 28 years ago. And last 2 weeks ago, we celebrated or honored him or did a tribute to him. He's been gone from us down here in the regular land, and he's on up there doing some Recycling Black Dollars in his father's land. And so that was 9 years ago. So we're going to turn it over to you.
All right.
Welcome to the show, Faith.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. M-U-H-A-M-M-A-D, capital A, period, N-A-S-S-E-R-D-E-E-N, a.k.a. the RBD man, b.k.a. Mo. He is the life that led us to our very existence today, the breath behind the creation of this sagacious group of beautiful, creative, resilient people. He's the eyes to the vision of the birthing of a new dimension of the true existence of our financial black dollar culture. The ears that heard enough and said, enough is enough. We must make a move to proclaim and sustain what we've worked so hard to build. The mover of the vehicle that has driven us and this legacy thus far, let's do him the honor to keep it moving and grooving. The hero of the power that we as a people are united, that through our poised collaborations, we are extraordinary, to say the least. The father of not only his beautiful children, but to a community of hundreds of thousands. The husband to a phenomenal, exquisite, humble woman, the son of a legacy that immediately decided to join him on his next journey, the brother to not only his siblings, but to those who called him Mo, the neighbor to so many beyond his block, beyond his neighborhood, beyond his city. He is the mover, the shaker, the let's get ready to rumble and let's wrestle to keep the dollars, the resources, the capital in our community by putting dollars in another black man's hand. The just do it for the better good of us all kind of guy. He is Muhammad A. Nazarene, the one and only RBD man, our one and only Mo. Thank you.
Isn't that beautiful?
Very inspiring, very touching. That's great. That is amazing.
Thank you.
You should record, you should copyright that thing.
You got an attorney sitting right over there.
Yeah. That's amazing. How did you come up with that, Faith?
Well, you know, I was actually really inspired. Jackie B, who is the co-president with Crystal of Recycling Black Dollars, approached me, and it started out, she just wanted me to speak about the books that I have published.
Right.
And 2 weeks prior to the meeting, she called me and said, oh, T.S., I'm so sorry. You know, I didn't realize that that Tuesday is actually the day that the founder of RBD passed away. And I said, oh, no problem. And I was like, okay, we'll just put it off to another time. Mm-hmm. I won't worry about it. She said, but if you want to do something, you can. And I said, okay, before I really thought about it, because I just felt honored to be a part of the group. They're all such beautiful people, literally inside and out. And when I hung up the phone with her, and then I called her a couple of days later, and I asked her, I said, you know, I've been looking online, and this man is phenomenal. Like, are you sure you want me to do it? I never had a chance to meet him. I'm only reading all this information about him. And she said, yeah, I know whatever you're gonna do is going to be fine. So she was telling me actually about the last time that she and he were together. And it was the day he passed away. They were in the office. And I just listened to every detail, and I started really tapping into some of the key words she was saying. And then as I was reading articles and researching him and just finding out who this gentleman was, here we are with this poetic tribute to him. And once again, even when I read it, I almost feel like I had the opportunity to touch his hand. Mm-hmm. And on that day in the meeting, there were probably about 10 to 12 other people that spoke before me. And each one of them had a key word that was in this tribute to him. And I was like, okay, this is all meant to be. And it was just a great experience. Great experience. I'm so humbled. I can't wait to meet his wife. So I would love to read it to her live.
And it's interesting because one of his daughters is a journalist. She used to write, we had a newsletter when Muhammad was alive, and she did the newsletter articles. So we'd have to make sure you meet her and introduce you to her. But what was phenomenal is that you become, you're a new member of RBD.
Mm-hmm.
So
just joined
we want to give a shout out to T.S. Faith for being a new member of RBD. But I did know Muhammad. And you encapsulated him. For someone that had never met Muhammad, you encapsulated his very fiber, because the one thing about Recycling Black Dollars was he wasn't just a founder or the president or the CEO of RBD. He was RBD. It was his complete consciousness. And the day he did die, you know, there is so many people within Los Angeles that have said, I just spoke to Muhammad this morning, or I had was going to do a deal with him, or we were going to do a film together. He also had a radio show. In fact, Felicia's dad, who's an engineer at KTYPM, he was his engineer and put his show together. He was his producer. So it's just so many people in Los Angeles that were connected to Muhammad on so many different levels all over the place. And everywhere I go, I meet people who are like, oh my God, we were like this. So you captured, I don't know how he channeled himself through you. That was Muhammad. You not to have met Muhammad, that's why I was so impressed with her. I was like, oh no, she's got to be on the show.
They are very talented.
Very, very talented. So with that, all that other stuff that you did over here, that's nothing compared to what your inspiration is. So tell us about your books. And
so actually it was last year in April, it was a day I was off work. I was working part-time, and I was checking emails, and a colleague of mine emailed me. She was in her first year of her master's program, and like I said, it was April, and she was like, I don't think I can go another year, and it's too tough, and she's working full-time. what a better person to talk to, because I've been down that road. I worked full time through my 3-year master program. So I was just encouraging her, you know, just hold on. I know, trust me, I know it's tough giving up your weekends. You're doing homework all the time, papers all the time, but it's going to be worth it. And so I went to look for something just to put for a food for thought, and I wrote it myself. And I was like, oh, did I write that? And so I literally went to save it just so I could use it, because I love, people who know me know I love texting them in the morning, or even in my emails, often I like to put a food for thought. And I said, oh, so I don't have to remember what I said, the words I used, how it went. I'll just save it. So I opened up a blank document and I saved it. And a year and a few months later, I just finished book 7 and submitting that. I'm waiting on the proof for book 6. All the books are inspirational, motivational quotes. And I have quotes from everything from life to the workplace, even in the time of loss, all about teamwork, management, leadership, spiritual quotes. So this has been an incredible journey for me. This was nothing that I had planned.
So have you been writing all your life? Or
no. This literally just started last year, April, me doing an email and responding to a friend who needed to hear something.
So you've written 7 books in...
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
But they're all quotes. And
all
I quotes. Always remind people.
But you wrote the quotes.
Yeah, they're all my quotes. But I haven't done a book myself yet. I am in a collaboration, like you saw, Crystal.
Okay.
On my Facebook. I've been so blessed to be a part of this collaboration with Dr. Will Moreland. He's housed out of Arizona, but he grew up here in California. And he started this project called Live Your Genius Now. And originally it was going to be about 14 of us, men and women, and just so the world could know that no matter where you are in your life, that you can do it. And through your perseverance, your determination, your willpower, and all of those things connected in one, that no matter the tragedies, the obstacles, the barriers that you come across, you can make it. And there's still a place for you to fulfill your destiny and pursue your purpose in life. And I was selected to be a part of that project. And we just actually day before yesterday, kicked off the pre-sales for the book. And what happened was, now it's just 10 women. And some of the women that are part of this book, one woman has experienced domestic violence. Another woman is living with HIV. Another woman challenged with mental illness. And all of these women are phenomenal, to say the least. And so once again, I'm surrounded by these people that are the epitome of courage and the epitome of I'm worth it. And I know that I can do this. And so, I mean, a couple of the women have nonprofit organizations. They have their own magazines. And I'm just like, just to be a part of that is so incredible for me. And it all started because a year ago, I put a quote on a blank page.
Wow.
Inspiration.
Very inspiring. Very much so. And I think it's kind of I had this conversation when I was at the women's conference was, are you living your life's purpose? Mm-hmm. And I think for everyone in this room, just from the enthusiasm that we're hearing and for wherever areas, and Fernando and what he's doing, and Michael and Chris and what they're doing, and Gilbert and I, and now you, it's just living in the purpose that this is why you were put on this planet. But I tell you, my sister, you are very, very talented. I can just see some amazing things in your future for you, with this blessing that God gave you, because you weren't even seeking this one.
No, I mean, as you see in my background, I spent 20 years working with family and children. Mm-hmm. I ended up getting my MSW in social work, and I did a little bit of that for a while. Mm-hmm. And, you know, sometimes I say things really, really. I mean, we cliche that phrase that, you know, things happen for a reason. Mm-hmm. But when you really tap into that, and at first I was a little frustrated because I was like, this is not what I wanted to do. And once I just started letting it flow, like I said, in a year and a couple of months, I'm on book 7. And it just comes really naturally. Before I was even finished with book 1, I had a rollover of quotes, not knowing they were going to be book 2 and not even realizing that they're all so tailored. Like I said, I have life quotes. I have quotes for the workplace, quotes for your spirits. I even have quotes for your morning. So
are you able to copyright any of your work?
Yeah, I already did that. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, took care of that. Yeah, thanks to
fantastic. Yeah, I am just Rose. So proud of you. That's who knew all of that wonderfulness? I believe we have a call that is coming in.
All right, let's hear it.
Hello, I'm calling regarding the business zone. The young lady is speaking now.
Oh, yes. Her name is Faith Wilson.
Oh, Faith Wilson.
Yes.
Okay. And then how could I get in contact with purchasing some of the books that she mentioned that she has?
Oh, we could have you talk to her right now. What? tell us your name and where you're calling from, please, caller.
My name is Joy, and I'm calling from Compton.
Uh-huh. Well, Joy, welcome to the show. We appreciate having you here. We'll have you speak with Faith directly.
Hi, Joy. It's a pleasure to have you call in. I actually have a website that you can visit. It's www.31quotes.com.
And you mentioned that you're on Facebook?
I am on Facebook. My Facebook is TSW Faith.
Okay, all right. And then do you do, like, workshops? I'm concerned. I have a group of ladies that I think maybe would be beneficial to.
I have done some workshops. I've done presentations. Most of the time I've just spoken, particularly with women, just about us feeling good about ourselves, starting new journeys, because sometimes we don't really know how to embrace that. And then also just finding you and being comfortable with you. So those are some of the areas that I've touched on, particularly with women.
Okay, so I could probably just email you.
Yes, and I can also, I have a business line that you can reach me at if you want to write that down.
Yes, I do. What is it, please?
Okay, it's 858 900-3195.
Thank you so much. Be encouraged. You're doing a marvelous job.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for talking to me, ma'am.
Thank you, Joy, for calling in.
Thanks. Thanks, Joy. And Joy, keep listening to the show. Okay, are you a business owner, Joy? Joy? she left. Okay. So that was great.
Look at that. You already
inspired,
got some sales.
You just touched at least one person right there. You see that? That's amazing. That's phenomenal.
Yes,
just to let you know, you've got a contagious spirit.
Wow.
So when you speak and you speak to that rhythm right there, I'm telling you, it's really contagious.
Thank you.
So that's probably why you're hearing Joy and others calling.
Thank
so that's
you.
Amazing.
Thank
now,
you.
Do you have a business or?
So as a result of these books, I started Wilson Publishing House. Of course,
okay.
I don't have all the equipment, so I have a team of people that work with me.
Okay.
Dr. Rosie Milligan is who does all my edits, and she has a young lady that works with me on my covers.
Mm-hmm.
And then we go through Ingram Spark to actually have the books printed. And so I sell them myself. I have my website that does some of the sales for me. And I'm going to be honest, I was like some of your clients. I was so against social media, only because you hear all the bad things.
Right.
But now I'm an encourager of social media. I started off with Instagram. I fell in love with it because, you know, you can take these pictures, you can upload them.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, like one of my favorite ones is I took a picture. It was a really beautiful day of City Hall.
Mm-hmm.
And underneath it, I just wrote about how we as a people, and when I say as a people, I'm talking about as human beings, that we need to feel good about ourselves, to stand tall and to fight for who we are. And then I have other pictures, you know, sometimes it's just a beautiful flower, a plant. And I just talk about how you have to nurture your soil.
Mm-hmm.
And what are you going to nurture your soil with? With optimism, with comfort, with peace, with joy. And so that's why I fell in love with Instagram. And then I also have Twitter. And the funny thing about Twitter is, you know, they only give you so many characters.
Right.
So I love it because sometimes I have this wonderful idea, this quote that I want to put on there, but then I have to shorten it. So I love the challenge of saying what I want to say in a few words. And then finally, I launched Facebook just in September, and it has been an absolute joy. So just to touch on what you said, I'm encouraging people to, you've got to use social media. It's just a world out there. Like you said, I mean, Africa.
Yeah.
Wow. That's incredible.
Right at your fingertips.
Right. How you can reach people and go places. and just be a part of this universe.
So here's what we would like to do. We'd yes. like to encourage you the right way. And our goal here is to foster, grow, and be advocates for small businesses and okay. entrepreneurs. So we're going to encourage you to start your business the right way.
Okay.
So you should link up with Fernando over there, get started with the business plan classes. Crystal can provide you the assistance with bookkeeping and accounting. And I will help you with your infrastructure.
Okay.
So what I'm going to do to get you started, I'm going to give you a free subscription to okay. Small Biz Pro.
Thank
you. So you can use that to start gathering your key documents, your business license, your insurance, and all of those other key things.
Okay.
Okay?
Thank you.
So, and when next time you when it's time to negotiate that big deal, that big book deal, yeah. you're going to go call
there
the
you go.
Law group, and they're right. going to be get your, because you got to have an attorney when you're operating in that space, right, guys?
Absolutely.
So you got to have that because, I mean, you could have people wanting to use your quotes in their music, and you want to make sure you're well represented and not because, you know, that's a different area. But very powerful. You could do so well in that. And then I'm going to circle that around over there to Miss Felicia. I think you need a podcast because I think people need to hear you. They need to hear you. And this is a perfect venue for that. God has given you an amazing gift. So please use it. And I was definitely inspired. I didn't get it on tape then because my phone, the battery died on it, but I got it on tape now. So I will make sure you get a copy of your, I'll clip this and I'll make sure you get a copy
okay.
of this and you
Thank
can put it
you.
On. Really amazing. And Muhammad, I'm going to speak for him because sometimes he channels himself through me and he would be just bowed down to, with honor that you did that. And I'm going to introduce you to, do you know Dr. George Frazier?
No, I haven't okay. met him. I heard of
so
him.
So the next time he comes through here, because okay. You might want to go to the Power Network Conference, because he'll be here in January.
Okay.
And you might want to be there for that, because okay. that's a whole other kind of world. And to uplift you to what you're doing, there was so much talent there.
Wow.
So we want to make sure you are successful.
Definitely.
And so get their cards before you leave.
I
think you're going to need them.
I will. And, you know, I'll just say really quickly, it's so funny that you mentioned the big deals, because that's where my vision is for my books. Like, my books are the excellent resources for any business, no matter if it's food, no matter if you're in a hospital. I mean, two of my books are great for employees. Two books are great because sometimes organizations, companies, they're not in a position, especially small businesses, mm-hmm. to give salary increases. And these books, I mean, something that you can give mm-hmm. to your employees that yeah. they can hold on to for the rest of their lives. Yeah. That is the vision for Wilson Publishing House. So mm-hmm. that's where I'm headed. So yes, Blue, I will need you.
And look at that. She already did the rhyme.
Well, yeah, thank you so
she's
much.
She's going some places there. Thank you so
Appreciate
much, Faith,
it.
For
thank
coming
you.
Out and doing
thank
that
you.
For me.
And Fernando, thank you also.
Yes.
We truly appreciate it. And again, tell us again when your classes are and where you're located.
We are located in the 1130 West Slauson Avenue in Los Angeles. And the zip code is 90044. And our phone number is area code 323-753-2335. Okay, yes, Vermont Slauson. In the next class start in November 15, 2016.
Okay, perfect.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank
and we
you.
Truly appreciate having both of you on the show today. It's now 5:10, so we will be signing out in about 10 minutes. So we'll take this time for ourselves, Crystal and I. So Crystal.
Yes.
Let's talk a little bit about what you've done, what you've accomplished over the past week.
Oh,
what
my gosh.
What have you been doing?
I've been super, super busy. You guys know I'm out there making things happen. So as I said at the beginning of the show, we're working on creating or finding access or changing the way we have access to capital. So there's some initiatives going on out the city. I mean, yesterday I was at this an event It was a workshop and roundtable. And now all of a sudden everybody's on the bandwagon. They want to help all our small businesses, mm-hmm. all our black and brown small businesses. Mm-hmm. So we're going to take advantage of it. Oh, yeah. There's a lot of money that they're saying they're going to push our way, and they're going to change some stuff. So we're going to force their hand and make sure they do.
And hold them accountable.
One of the things, though, we have been going around doing a series of roundtables to get the feedback from our business owners, our small business owners. And this one's also being fueled by the Milken Institute. We have identified eight black lenders that is going to put up $10 million for a fund for small businesses, for startups, all the way up to growth businesses, with criteria that's going to meet our population, and as well. So this is for the Hispanic, for the black, and the African American, and the Hispanic. And Milken is going to put up the balance of the $5 million. So we're going to have a $15 million fund that is going to be there for our businesses. But what Milken wants is the data. They need to hear from our small businesses on what has been the challenges, what has been the obstacles from them acquiring financing and capital and lines of credit for their businesses. So that's the first line. The second line of it is how an initiative to create jobs and what we need to do. So this is all about solution. They're no longer just talking. This is about solution. And then the third piece of that is to create wealth creation and legacy within our communities. So we need to hear from our small business owner. There's going to be a roundtable meeting here in probably in the next week or so. We're waiting for Kern Price to give us a date, his date. And at that point, we're looking to have at least 200 bodies in a seat. We will announce where that's going to take place. We've already done it in Inglewood. We've already done it at the airport. After we leave Los Angeles, we need 700 voices by February when we're going to launch the fund. Okay, and then from here, we're moving to the Pomona, the Inland Empire, and we're going to get their feedback there. And from there, we're going to Antelope Valley. And then we'll round back, and then the launch is going to take place in February of next year, 2017, and that fund will be in place. But we need to hear from you so you can tell us what has been your challenges. Last week, we had a guest on the show, mm-hmm. and even though these individuals had an amazing business, they then went from zero to $6 million mm-hmm. fixing beans and cheese.
That's right.
That's the name. The company is called Amerisol Foods. $6 million. These are two women, mother and a daughter. But for 4 years, it took them 4 years to get capital mm-hmm. to take their business to the next level. That's ridiculous.
It's a Latina-owned business. They're from El Salvador.
Mm-hmm.
And they came here with nothing. The mom, you know, she is a single mom. She brought her kids, three kids with her,
mm-hmm.
and it was just phenomenal. So they started going door to door trying to sell their beans and their cheeses, you know, ethnic cheese and beans from El Salvador. And it's, you know, it slowly picked up. Everyone rejected them. They went to get a loan. SBA wouldn't talk to them. Banks wouldn't talk to them. No one would rent to them. And then they try to do it on their own. And as soon as things start picking up, they enroll in my classes for 2 years. They enroll in the Business Management Academy that I teach for the National Latina Business Women Association. And the first time they came to the class, I knew they were winners. You know, you can look at some entrepreneur and you can tell that they're winners. I could tell because they were paying attention to what I was saying. the things that I was saying, I was disseminating, they were paying attention and they regurgitated it. So that's how I know that they're going to be stars, because they're listening. And then at the end of the first year, they were able to purchase a building. They bought their own building,
mm-hmm.
generating at the time $4 million in sales. You see what I'm saying?
Gosh.
I am just so excited about these guys. So we're going to be working with them closely and help them with some more certifications. But
the issue is it took the time it took for them to rise their business. There's another business that had been doing business for 20 years. His the business is a restaurant, Uncle Daryl's, and he had been down in the marina for the last 20-something years. Mm-hmm. He didn't own his building, and we have to stress how important it is for you as a business owner to own the property your business is in. Because 20 years later, he had a very established clientele in the marina right off of Lincoln. Then the owners of the building said, we no longer want you here. Mm-hmm. They gave him 1 month. He didn't even have time enough to let his clients or his customers know. He then had to pick up his business and move it to Carson. And it took him 3 years to even get the doors open. He used all of his capital, everything, trying to go through all the bureaucracies of reopening. And he is starting all over again. Mm-hmm. Now, after being in business for 20 years, and now you're starting from scratch with no money. Because he's back there to no money because he had to use it in the time it took for all the licensing and the permits and all that sort of stuff. That's just not right.
See, this is part of the reason why I truly, truly respect small businesses. Because small businesses go through challenges that large businesses don't go through. Large businesses, they get a grant or they get fund from their family or some rich person give them money.
Oh, they don't have to pay any taxes like Donald Trump.
Yeah, they don't have to pay any taxes. You see what I'm saying? With us, we start scrapping, and as soon as we start making, guess what the landlord does? You're making money. Okay, I'm going to figure out how to get you. Yeah. So they either try to increase the rent or they tell you, you got to get out. You see what I'm saying? You also have some interesting numbers on loans to African-Americans, right?
I actually do.
Oh, yes.
In fact,
I think we need to share this with our audience.
So when I was at the Plum yesterday, in 2012, only 8.7% of the Hispanic-owned businesses and 4.2% of the African-American-owned businesses had employees. African-Americans own roughly 9% of the small business in the U.S., but received 3.7% of the SBA 7As in 2016. From 2007 to 2012, minority-owned firms increased by 38%, while non-minority firms declined by 11%. Hispanics own approximately 12% of the U.S. small businesses, but receive only 6% of the small business, the SBA 7A loan guarantees. Those numbers are ridiculous. Yes. That is ridiculous. And the actual numbers, and I think you were here when I mentioned this, that 69 loans for the African American community, 48 loans, and we started out at probably 14 loans, but that's crazy.
Yeah.
When we have over 400 to 800 in the state of California alone, there are 800,000 African American business owners.
Yeah.
And then when you add in the Latino businesses, because some of them operate under the radar as well, like our businesses. So you know, a lot of cash and carry businesses. So they don't have the documentation. They don't have. So we have to change that. We have to, because we're missing out on so many opportunities. And for the next to 2019, there's going to be over $700 billion on the street for people to acquire through contracts and so forth. So we have to prepare our businesses.
Yes.
Because Los Angeles, we may not see a growth like this. So if we get the Olympics, we need to make sure our business by 2024 are in position so that they can benefit from the Olympics. We're going to have the Super Bowl here. Yes. We're going to have a new football stadium. We're going to have the
money coming in.
Airport. So our people need to be part of this.
Yes. And that's part of the reason why we're here at the Business Zone. We're working on getting businesses business ready, contract ready, and bank loan ready. With our program that we offer, Chris Still and I, we do a lot of great things, and we're doing it through our Small Biz Pro program as well. As a matter of fact, tomorrow I'm teaching a class in San Dimas. This class is for the National Latina Business Women Association. I do an 8-week program for them, but we'll have about 12 to 15 participants enrolled learning how to use Small Biz Pro tomorrow. And what that is going to do is to teach them how to build their infrastructure, how to structure their business so they can maintain and manage their documents, their paperwork, and their back office. That's been a challenge for small businesses. Mm-hmm. Many small businesses do not know how to manage their paperwork. Yes. So that's what we're going to teach them how to do with this system right here, Small Biz Pro. So we've donated this to you, which is going to be great. And we're also going to do that for a lot of other small businesses. So, Crystal, seem like we're running out of time here.
I got two. Well, actually, we start a little late. So let's do. There's a couple things happening. We're hosting. It's being sponsored by Southern California Edison, and we're hosting a how to prepare for government and utility contracting. It's an SEC or Southern California Edison Supplier Diversity and Development 2016 EDGE program. So we want you to come out. We're going to, one of the workshops, which is going to be Thursday, November 10th, is going to be subcontracting strategies. How to go about doing that. The date is November 10th on Thursday, 2016, and it's from 9 a.m. to 12:30.
Where?
At the Los Angeles Urban League at 3450 Mount Vernon Drive in Los Angeles. And it's free admission. And we want you to come out to learn about that. The second workshop is going to be Tuesday, November 15th, and that is from 9 to 12:30 as well. And it's going to be on writing a winning proposal. So we want you to come out, call us, go on RBDRecyclingBlackDollars.org or RBDMedia.org. You can see the information also on my Facebook page, the Business Zone Facebook page. And one other thing before we go is there on November 16th, there is a Black Men's Town Hall meeting, Where Are My Brother's Keepers? It is the assault against Black men in the U.S. has created a lot of trauma and impact in our community. So it's going to be hosted from 4 to 7 p.m. at Darby Park, which is at 3400 West Arborvita Street in Inglewood. It is at the Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Community Center. It is being sponsored by the Los Angeles County Mental Health Department and NAMI, which is the National Association of Mental Health. And we need to talk about what racism, what violence, what the pressure and the stigma is creating within our communities, and how it is creating a place of unwholeness, and we need to heal. So we need to have these conversations. So please come out 4 to 7. It's free admission as well. They're going to have some $25 giveaways. Everybody is welcome, and there's free food, and that's Darby Park. That is in the city of Inglewood. Where Are My Brother's Keepers? We have to, as a community, come together and hold each other up and unite so that we can overcome the challenges that are keeping us down.
And usually I don't do this on our radio show, but I'm going to do it this time because I really think it's important, not only for small businesses, but for people within themselves. Make sure you go out and vote.
Oh, yeah. Very, very
Make
important.
Make sure
man.
You vote. Okay? If you're not registered by now, I'm sorry. You've missed it. But you gotta vote. If you don't vote, you don't have a voice. Don't complain about not getting opportunities. Don't complain about not getting people to assist you. Go vote.
And this is a very serious and very important that we all vote. We might not be completely agreeable about all of the candidates. One we are definitely not wanting there. I will not say which one, but there's one we truly don't want there. The other one you might have some reservations, but I tell you, in this case, you want the other one. And it's also important that we understand there's a lot of propositions, and a lot of those propositions are going to carry some major impact on our, especially the black and the brown. So I'm going to keep saying that, people. We have to vote for those. If you don't vote for them too, make sure you vote for the
propositions. And make sure you read the propositions and understand them first before you vote on them.
Right.
A lot of them have taxes hidden in there. So you need to understand them. So our time is up, Crystal.
Yes. So it's been a great
done
week.
Another
Thank
great
you,
show.
Blue Log Group. Thank you, Fernando from Thank Vermont Slauson. Thank you, Faye. We had a fantastic.
Excellent show.
Wasn't that a fast 2 hours?
Wow.
And you all are listening to The Business Zone. We're on every Friday from 3 to 5. Tune into MarsMediaLive.com, and you'll hear the best of the best.
And we're for out. Those of you that were on Facebook Live, you will see the show in its entirety with all the other people if you go to Morris Media Live and also to the Business Zone with Crystal and Gilbert, our Facebook page, and you'll get to see the people, and they were all dressed so nice today, and they all came ready to give you guys what they had. So thank you, and we will see you next week. Bye-bye.
We're out.
Bye-bye.